Grace and peace to you. It's Wednesday, March 3rd. This is a season of Lent, a time of ashes. Ashes to remind us to lament, to confess, and to repent. Oh God, you look for truth deep in me and teach me wisdom in my heart. Welcome to this time of prayer. My name is Kay Huggins, and I'm the Parish Associate at Second Presbyterian Church in Albuquerque, New Mexico. This is a circle of prayer composed of close friends from Second Pres, as well as friends in Christ, some of whom names we do not know. We gather together at various times throughout the day, and with Christians around the world, we listen to the daily readings. These texts give us an opportunity to soak in God's Word, as well as to lift up praise and celebration for the life we have, and petitions for those about whom we are concerned. Such praying is a blessing extended into the world as freely as God's grace, and a blessing received as precious as God's love. Thank you for joining us. Your prayers enrich our service. If you want to know more about our practice, read the weekly welcome posted on the Second's webpage. But all you really need to know is this: everyone needs a little mercy now. And so we're going to begin, as we always do, with a prayer based on the psalm. The psalm of the day today is Psalm 26, and I hope that you will read it sometime during the day. The refrain is, O God, be merciful to us and save us. Let us pray. Jesus, Lamb of God, you take away the sins of the world. Give us grace to avoid sin and strength to be faithful to you. Lead us to the place where God dwells in glory, that we may join with all the saints to praise God with joy now and forevermore. Amen. O God, be merciful to us and save us. The text begins as Jesus goes up to Jerusalem. We do not know if he went on his own, for no mention is made of his disciples. But there is one interesting detail. Jesus entered by the sheep gate, a gate that was usually used to lead the sacrificial animals into the temple market or directly to the temple officials. No sheep ever returned from this gate. It was a gate of death. Behold, the Lamb of God. I'm reading from John 5, the first 18 verses. After this, there was a festival, a Jewish festival, and Jesus went up to Jerusalem. In Jerusalem, near the Sheep Gate, in the north city wall, is a pool that had the aromatic name Bethsaida. It had five covered porches, and a crowd of people who were sick, blind, lame, and paralyzed sat there. A certain man was there who had been sick for 38 years. And when Jesus saw him lying there, knowing that he had already been there a long time, he asked him, "Do you want to get well?" And the sick man answered him, "Sir, I don't have anyone who can put me in the water when it is stirred up. When I try to get in, someone else has gotten in ahead of me." Jesus said to him, "Get up, pick up your mat, and walk." And immediately the man was made well. He picked up his mat and he walked. Now that day was the Sabbath. And the Jewish leaders said to the man who had been healed, "It's the Sabbath, and you aren't allowed to carry your mat." The man answered, "The one who made me well said to me, 'Pick up your mat and walk.'" They inquired, "Who is this man that said to you, 'Pick it up and walk'?" The man who had been cured didn't know who it was because Jesus had slipped away from the crowd gathering there. Later, Jesus found him in the temple and said, "See, you are made well. Don't sin anymore, in case something worse may happen to you." And the man went and proclaimed to the Jewish leaders that Jesus was the man who had made him well. And as a result, the Jewish leaders were harassing Jesus since he had done these things on the Sabbath. Jesus replied, "My Father is still working, and I am working too." For this reason, the Jewish leaders wanted even more to kill him, not only because he was doing away with the Sabbath, but also because he called God his own Father, thereby making himself equal with God. Inside the sheep gate, there was a pool thought to have healing waters. Miracles were performed there, and many came for ritual bathing, especially when the spring was active and the water roiling. Jesus observed a lame man and inquired as to his desire for healing. The man explained he needed help, and there was never anyone to help him. Jesus responded, as if announcing, "I'm here, I can help." He commanded the man to pick up his mat and walk, and he did. And he began to walk, but he was carrying that mat. Carrying anything in public was rigidly prohibited on the Sabbath. So the man probably didn't take more than a few steps. After all, it was Jerusalem during festival time, and of course, he met some Jewish leaders. And of course, the pious religious leaders couldn't allow anyone to walk about carrying a mat on the Sabbath. Now, it's interesting that the man failed to be able to identify Jesus or know his name. But perhaps even more interesting is that Jesus found him later in the temple and recognized him, cautioned him to live carefully, lest he fall into new sins. This time, the man got Jesus' name and reported him to the religious authorities. And this initiated a new round of harassment. The harassment resulted actually in two charges against Jesus. First, that he healed on the Sabbath and encouraged the healed man to break Sabbath laws. And secondly, that he had referred to God as his Father, encouraging the Jewish leaders who assumed themselves to be, well, let's just say somewhat closer to God than a country bumpkin like Jesus. Do you see how Jesus' sense of God's authority in his actions got him into trouble? Can you imagine someone discrediting a miracle because the wrong person occasioned the healing? Can you, for example, imagine someone taking credit for a miracle without reference to God? Authority, healing, and change of heart, as well as miracles, these are the profound issues that swirl around Jesus in his day and continue to become the substance of our prayers in our day. So let's turn to the prayers for Wednesday. Let's pray together. God of all mercies, we praise you that you have brought us to this day, brightening our lives with the dawn of promise and hope in Jesus Christ. Especially we thank you for ministries of discernment and governance, for those who teach and those who learn, for the community of faith in your church, and reconciliation in our relationships, and for all the gifts of healing and forgiveness. Merciful God, strengthen us in prayer that we may lift up the brokenness of this world for your healing and share in the saving love of Jesus Christ. Especially today, we pray for the church in Europe, for those who care about safe, clean, and renewable energy, for those who are lonely and forgotten, for those from whom we are estranged, and for the courage to claim your promise in Christ Jesus. Holy God, we come to you as a people dwelling in a season of change. We have borne the isolation of this pandemic for a year. We've altered our lifestyle. We've accepted new norms of social behavior. We've lost and mourned, experienced weakness, and sought courage. And now, on the edge of change, as vaccination rates increase, we pray for sustenance as we awake the new world that is forming. With the gentleness of spring blossoms unfolding and the energy of a push up of green where once was only brown, draw us into the future you are preparing. Whether we continue in isolation or are freed for greater social engagement, we will understand your justice and mercy at work in the world in which we live. We pray for those who are ill, for those facing new diagnoses and treatments, for those adjusting to conditions unexpected or accepting new limitations. We pray for all who are impacted by the conditions and concerns of others, especially for those, whether professional, family, or friends, who serve as caregivers. Bless each family unit and each individual in need of support. We name Toby and Bev, awaiting results from tests. Dora's sister-in-law following hip surgery. Harry H.'s nephew in Pennsylvania with COVID and a possible exposure to their daughter, Melissa. Tina and Julian recovering from COVID. Francis at home with Susie, his caregiver. Judy's brother, Randy, experiencing angina pains. Ruth and Richard continuing with cancer treatments. Rick and Marie, Carmen, Gabe and John, Joyce and her family. Bless with your support all who are mourning, especially bless Ella as she mourns the death of her younger brother after a lengthy struggle with cancer. And Vivian's aunt Joanne, whose friends were in an accident that killed the husband and hospitalized the wife. We pray for the community of Las Cruces following the accidental death of their superintendent of schools. Give support, hope, and comfort to each mourning soul. Holy God, receive our gratitude for the many who work to make our lives safe. Especially we honor and bless those who work in government, in police, emergency, military, and foreign services, in the arts, sciences, education, and research, in agricultural, transportation, retail, and distribution systems, all spiritual leaders and charitable institutions working for justice, dignity, and the well-being of all. And all those whose contributions we may fail to notice. Thank you for inspiring those who bring the world together in joyful and just ways. As it is our practice, we pray for your encouragement on those in the medical fields, in home health care, in short and long-term treatment facilities, in vaccination centers and neighborhood clinics, and in hospitals and treatment centers. Especially we pray for those we love, Carla, Nicole, Cassie, Sandra, Camilla, Feliz, Tilda, Karina, Emiko, Pat's daughter, Toby, together with her husband, Boyd, Pat's brother, Arthur, who, as Sandra's cousins, Melinda and Marshall, are working directly with COVID patients. Bless them, one and all. And now, with the confidence born of the love of Christ, we pray as we have been taught. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And now, friends, so far as it depends on us, let us live peaceably with all. Let the people say, Amen. Bless the Lord. Let the people say, the Lord's name be praised. Dear friends, know this day that you truly are one of Christ's beloved ones, and that Christ is praying for you, that you might live life fully and abundantly. Remember the refrain from Psalm 26, O God, be merciful to us and save us. And tuck into your hearts these words from Lamentations 3, verse 22. The Lord's unfailing love and mercy continue, fresh as the morning and sure as the sunrise. Go in peace.